Hello, good evening, good afternoon, good morning. I think good night from a very snowy Warsaw. It's the first time we have us real snow this year. I hope it's not the last time. My name is Magda Krasowska, and I have a great pleasure to speak to you tonight. I hope to be concise and get some interest in you in terms of fundraising, trying to find some various sources of inspirations and also new investment for your projects. Just one announcement. I have a presentation for you. I'll go through it quickly. I'll present some basic ideas. I will try to explain you main regulations when it comes to the various calls for proposals I'm familiar with, and then we will try to save up some time for individual discussions and any kind of question, and hopefully I'll have the answers for your questions. So let's get started. Okay. So, funding opportunities. As I said, my name is Magda. I'm a fundraiser. I've been writing proposals for more than 15 years. I'm also a project manager, currently working at a big civil society program, Active Citizens Fund. Supporting civil society organizations in Poland. In my experience, I've been already a city officer, a librarian, a project coordinator for young musicians. So I can say that transsectoral cooperation is one of my passions. And let me say that it's going to be one of my main points of view. But a quick introduction to some grants reality. I'll try to debunk some myths and also dispel some doubts about the grants. I'm not sure to what extent you are experienced when it comes to fundraising and any kind of grant proposals writing, but I'm going to present you briefly main themes and main personas when it comes to the grant reality. So, who is the donor, the mythical donor? Donor is actually either a private company, it can be a public institution, it can be a government, it can be non-governmental organization, it's just an institution which is actually donating money for some defined purposes because it has some strategic and or political agenda. But why this donor is going to support us, I mean our organization, our company, us as the creators, as a creative producers, whoever you may find interested in. Because we will do it better. So simplifying, we as grant beneficiary have a specific know-how and know with whom we are doing these specific things we are asked for. We are flexible enough. We have enough resources. Our resources are of great quality, and we can achieve very good, better results than the donor itself, because we can imagine that we might have much bigger potential and know-how, skills, and competencies. For instance, comparing to the employees of Ministry of Culture, because they have totally different competencies, and we can do it much better, much more efficient than they. Or there is a certain policy or political agenda to support certain sector. Why? One of the strategic ways of supporting, for instance, civil society is to strengthen the civil society organizations which are actually active for development of communities, supporting grassroots initiatives. That's why. So these are two main words, I think, when it comes to the grant reality, donor and grant beneficiary. So what else? Donor, as I said before, donor usually either, even if it's a government or it's the institution, should have its mission and vision. And it could be able to consciously formulate areas of support. So tell the people, okay, I'm expecting you to do this and that. And all these do's and that should be put into the rules and regulations. And rules and regulations are like a Bible for any person who is writing a proposal. So again, what is the rules and regulations? Rules and regulations are intended to indicate us what the donor expects from us. So it is usually a document stating clearly, or sometimes less clearly, but specifically the areas and scope of work we are expected to deliver, formats of work. So for instance, whether we could organize conference, or we should organize big campaign in social media, or maybe we can produce interactive resource like a video game. The rules and regulations, specific guidelines, should tell us also about the budget limitations, so how much money we can get. And maybe there is something called, and it's very scary, called your own contribution. So that means that this donor is not going to give us all the money we are applying for. This means that we need to make the effort and collect some money to put it into the budget of this project ourselves. It's very different. Some of the sources of funding sponsors 100%, while the others can sponsor up to 80% and the others 50%. It really differs. The rules and regulations will also tell us what is the timeline we are expected to close the whole project. Because as you of course know, each project has to have a beginning and the end. So within this indicated time frame, we are supposed to deliver the expected result and the product we described in the project proposal. There is also another very scary and bad word, which is eligibility. So not all the costs you want to finance from this specific budget are eligible. That means that if you put them into the project budget, they will be not financed, or they will make your whole proposal ineligible. That means you are done, you are cancelled. Unfortunately, you didn't go through. Eligibility concerns also eligible entities. So in some programs, to be the eligible entity, you have to be public institution or a non-governmental organization or a private company. Again, it differs, but it also highlights this point that you have to be very careful in terms of which kind of institution is eligible to apply for funding. So, priorities and beneficiary areas of work should match rules and regulations. So what does it mean? That if you are, for instance, a private company, which is a construction company, it's rather better for you if you don't apply for production of video game, because simply you are not credible. You have to be able to express, articulate and expose your areas, your priority areas and areas of your expertise. Grant types might be very various, and they might create a possibility to solve local, national, regional, up to the global level problems. Grants are also given to the projects, which of course have limited capacities and time. The expected results are usually defined on the project level. So at the very beginning, while writing the proposal, you say that you are going to deliver this and that, and the change your project will bring about will eventually evoke 15 people trained, or 2 video games produced, or 5 conferences, 60 more jobs on the market, etc., etc. This is what is going to happen within the project. But there is also a story which should actually have happened after the project finished. So what is this story? This is called project sustainability, and another bad, scary word like multiplication ability. So this shows to what extent your project can survive once the funding is over. And it's very important, I think, from your perspective, as the video games have absolutely this kind of possibility to go into the world and conquer it after the project ends. So while thinking about applying for funding, you need to remember one basic thing, that project per se, the whole construct called project, is to give you a unique possibility to prototype, test, and experiment in a relatively safe environment, because you get this money, you know what to achieve. There are actually not many threats and risks coming from the outside world, or like from the market, from the commercial side. If you plan the project carefully, you get really high chances that you will go through it smoothly. The implementation period should be also not a big challenge for you. Then it's a very big chance again to try to do something new. Okay, what about the games? That again, one of my thoughts I would like to convey to you, the message when you are thinking about having a project about a game or get the funding, that game will never be a project goal. It could be one of the results, but usually you have to think about it as a tool which supports changes which are expected to happen within a project. So, what is actually a project? A project is a sum of various features, and what constitutes the final success of the project are 3 main factors: thoughtfully diagnosed recipients' needs, analyzed organization resources, and quality of solutions we are going to provide within this project. So all these 3 areas, all these 3 factors are actually decisive when it comes to the final result of the project. Okay, so let's now switch to the most, I think, interesting subject for you, which are the programs for games. I did this research for you through the international programs, through the international calls for proposals. There are quite a few. Unfortunately, there are not so many when it comes to direct funding, which says, okay, this is the program for games. And the only, I believe, program which is financing video games is a big program of European Union, which is called Creative Europe. Creative Europe is the community program which supports various interpretation manifestations of culture and its commercial branch, which is creative sector. That's why it's called Creative Europe. Subprogram of Creative Europe is in program media, and within the subprogram media, there 2 calls for proposals. Both happened last year, support for development of European video games, and support to access market. The story is now that we are now in the European Union ending the financial perspective. And starting from the next year, we will have another Creative Europe program. I was trying to find some more details about what kind of sub-programs are planned. So far, I think there is not going to be many changes, but I will look through it right now because we are getting closer to the year 2021. But what I found is this program will face a quite significant raise when it comes to the budget, and 1 billion going exclusively for media sub-program, which is kind of a good idea, with increased focus on cross-border collaborations and sectors such as virtual reality and digital innovation. So what I would recommend now is to wait a little bit before all these programs will be published, and then browse through and read very thoroughly the guidelines, the rules and regulations accordingly, so that you could try to apply for some funding. This is the link. I'm going, of course, to send it to you later, how to search within the Creative Europe subprograms. Okay, but if not culture, then what? We could also try to get the indirect path, or to get some, you know, detour or pass by, whatever you call it, and try to define a game as a tool for social impact. But for that, you need to try harder. You need to get to some more in-depth analysis and reflection about what you're actually about to do. What would you like to change? Whether you are preparing, producing the games for commercial purposes only, or maybe your intentions are quite different. If yes, then there are some more opportunities for you. And these opportunities might be actually assigned within two big areas, like education, communities, and culture. And I'd like to focus for a couple of minutes on the educational programs and give you some hints when it comes to specific way of thinking, what might be a key factor for narrative justifying a presence of video game in the educational project. So what could video game do? Raise awareness. Try to embed habits, traditions of critical thinking and information literacy. It can also stimulate and trigger creativity. It could support new skills development, also community learning. Very up-to-date and fashionable trend right now. It can also strengthen the outreach to the favorized groups. So there is one program which is European-wide called Erasmus Plus. So basic facts and figures about the Erasmus Plus. Erasmus Plus have a lot of various actions, sub-programs, etc. And the one I would like to tell you about is called Strategic Partnerships. It's about staff competences and learning. So strengthening, extending staff competences and also their ability to work with beneficiaries, users, students, adults, whoever they teach. What is important within this program is called production of innovative educational resources. And in this context, your game is the innovative educational resource. It's either formulated like that in the call for proposals. I believe there is like interactive resource. So the video game is according to the Erasmus Plus interactive resource. And what is also important, results dissemination and multiplication. So it's of high importance, of great significance to the Erasmus Plus program to provide and ensure that the results which are created within the project are being properly disseminated. So They reach out to big number of people, various groups of people. There are special groups of people with the special needs, people with special educational needs, people with disabilities, etc. So all of them have to be taken into account while thinking about this kind of projects. And I believe, again, that video games are just perfect for this kind of priority, let's say, due to their high level of multiplication. So these projects might be organized with participation of schools, institutions. They might concern vocational training, adult education. What are the priority areas? It's language, STEM. That means the acronym stands for science, technology, engineering, and lifelong learning, work-based learning, etc. Mathematics. It's also of high priority to put transsectoral cooperation again, which is perfect for you because then you can establish a cooperation with either a public institution, a school, a library, any kind of NGO which is active in the, for instance, digital field. And again, results, dissemination, and multiplication. So a few more facts, a few more details about the program. You have to have three partners from three countries, but to be a partner, you cannot be a private company. You can be public, you can be NGO, you can be non-commercial institution. You must be a private company. So these projects last up to 36 months. And what is good also for the people who are just beginning their way to raise funding or to apply for grants, the budget is very, very simple. So it doesn't need tons of paper, any kind of bureaucracy. It's very easy because it's based on lump sums. I'm going to tell a few words about it later. And the maximum sum you can apply for is 450,000 euro. So I was trying to show you what kind of budget categories you can apply. It's not like the maximum total, but they are like rough figures you may include into your analysis, what is doable and what is not doable. So again, these are very simple and big budget chapters. So you can get some money for management simply. You can get some extra money for traveling. You can also train people, and you can train people who are working in your organization. Multiplier events is simply to promote whatever you produce, whatever you deliver within the project. You can meet with people, you can train them, you can show them, you can test it with them, whatever. And there is also some money. If you, for instance, if you are not a representative of any kind of eligible institutions, you're just a private company, there is also money for outsourcing. So we can also actually consider an opportunity, an option that you're only delivering a video game for some kind of a partnership. And this partnership can outsource the production of this game for the amount mounting up to 50,000 euro. But also there is another, let's say, strategy to apply, but it's applicable only in case you are the eligible entity. So just to remind you, you're a public or NGO, not a commercial organization, not a private company. So all the money, like equation is 450,000 minus 36, 30, 20, 20, 50,000. All this money theoretically can go, if you're approved, if your project is approved, all this money can go to the intellectual output. And within the intellectual output, you can also produce the game. You can produce a scenario, you can produce also a manual, you can produce the training, you can do quite a lot of stuff within this option of intellectual outputs. So my recommendation is to really, if you are interested in educational games or games of educational profile, for students, for higher education institutions, for people with special needs, for adult educators, for vocational training. You need to establish a cooperation with the institution which has a appropriate profile. Why? You need to present a proper know-how and expertise. And here, as I said, intellectual output might be a very good option for you, as they may finance the budget for intellectual outputs. It may finance various forms of your game production. So this is the Erasmus Plus. There is also another huge, huge program, which is called Horizon 2020. I'm going just to mention it briefly. This is for research and innovation actions, basically for academia and research organizations. There is, again, big groups of various sub-programs, just to name a few: science with and for society, societal challenges, which I believe may have some place in budget and also in ideas, in outreach tools, because the game is, again, a great outreach tool. These projects are for 3 up to 5 million euro, and they are also multi-annual projects. But this is something you have to be very advanced to apply for. But maybe you are, so of course, I don't exclude such a possibility. I just wanted to mention it in case somebody wants to follow this opportunity. And there is also a specific calendar for this lots and lots for proposal within the horizon. So I highly recommend you to browse it through and try to read the guidelines. Good luck. Quite complicated, but still, this is a good opportunity. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about the integration projects, about the projects for community. So I wanted to show you also another source of funding, which is not European Union. And this is the European Economy Area, so-called Norway grants and Norway grants. So basically how it works, it's money coming from Norway, Iceland and Liechtenstein, which are, as you know, not a part of European Union, but since they are using some privileges as all the citizens of European Union, they established some kind of funding supporting the, let's say, developing countries within the European Union, growing markets, etc. It's a lot of money, and it's being distributed in 16 EU countries, basically so-called new member states, starting from the year of 2004. Plus Greece and Portugal, and they are signed at the level of government. So government of Norway, Iceland and Liechtenstein signed separately memorandum of understanding with each separate country out of the 16. And in each country, there is a number of different programs supporting various areas of life. So it might be civil society, which is actually everywhere, and I'm going to tell you about it a little bit later. It might be business, it might be environment, it might be climate change, it might be justice, law, youth, culture, are among the program topics. It differs from country to country. So again, you may check it on the website, what is currently available in your country. These grants are usually for the institutions which are registered in specific country, but you may also have some partners within the group of these 16 people. So maybe starting from Estonia, going through the Eastern Bloc of European Union up to Greece and Portugal on the west. So one program I would like to mention briefly is Unlocking Youth Potential, financed from the Norway grants. The deadline is January 5th, so it's pretty close. It's 1 up to 2 million euro. Institutions from two countries from beneficiary states. And this is for people who are not educated, not employed. So it's, I think the acronym is NEETS. And they are young, so neither they have a proper education, neither they got a job. And different tools which are being projected for this activities, which is innovation, exploration, transfer of know-how, etc. Basically, it's about to develop a bunch of tools which would encourage and support the young people and improve their access to the job market and their competences, of course. Active Citizens Funds. Again, this is Norway grants, but this is for civil society. And I'm just coming from the big picture of international projects. I'm slowly going to Poland because Active Citizen Fund is now in Poland for many years. The main subject is support for civil society development, and the themes, the focus is on protection of human rights, building diversity, supporting, empowering the minority groups. And it's also planned to develop the involvement and build a democratic culture. So these are the priority areas. And in Poland, this fund is divided in two. For the national part, where the operator is consortium with Batory Foundation. So here you can apply in a consortium as a partner with a separate budget, which is also very important. Grants are not super big, but again, you may try to finance a part of your production, or, and I would probably recommend it, some kind of dissemination. So using already existing game as a subject, as a basis for a training, for any kind of encouragement and involvement tools for community reasons. And since there are also public institutions like school, houses of culture, libraries involved, I think you will also get a great floor for your dissemination purposes. Currently, open call for proposal has its deadline again in January. So this is the program I work for. This is the regional branch of Active Citizen Fund. It doesn't really differ much. It's just the focus is on the smaller cities, smaller towns outside Warsaw. The rules are just the same. We are going to announce the first call mid-March, and the second call is going to happen next year. Maximum grant amount is approximately 80,000 euro for multi-annual projects. I think it's up to 2 years. So again, it's not like a lot of money because you need to manage this project, you need to pay some administrative costs, etc. But again, I'm very eager to have the projects with innovative solutions like video games while working with young people, for instance. I would love to see it. So again, this is the floor for you to experiment. Some miscellaneous sources of funding. There are also some other big calls for proposals or big programs like EuropeAid, which is dedicated to support various non-European Union countries in the specific areas which seems to be of high priority, usually for political reasons, and the same concerns endowment for democracy. This is the USAID, and the details for the next year are going to be published in mid-December. So I think from the American perspective, it's of high importance, for instance, to combat fake news and propaganda in the internet. So that might be a good inspiration for you when it comes to the theme for your productions. And also there are quite a lot of different private foundations. I will describe them in the material you're getting within a couple of days. And the last thing I would like to tell you is culture, but culture in Poland, because there is a special program supporting creative industries financed by the Ministry of Culture in Poland. Each year there are usually two calls for proposals. It differs because if they distribute all the money within the first one, and the first one has just ended up at the end of November, but there might be another, I think, in March usually. So this is the money for education, research, expert support, and for the whole process till testing. So from prototyping till testing without the whole promotion and dissemination part. And you can apply for up to 300,000 Polish zlotys, which is around 70,000 euro. And these are 1 year projects. So this is all for me now. Thank you for your attention. And this is the time for question and answers. Okay, so I'm now available on chat. So if anybody would like to ask me a question or join me on the video chat, we can talk, we can discuss any kind of burning issues you have in mind. I don't see actually. Okay. Oh, I see. Now I see your chat. Sorry. Okay. When it comes to the creative, your program to apply to bring the field for less. Okay. Could you recommend a funding opportunity for indie developers when they want to produce their first game? So I think like for now, I went through all the funding opportunities which are potentially known for me. I will continue my research, but I believe maybe the Ministry of Culture might be a good idea for you. Okay. Do you have any tips on how to start building international partnerships to apply to this kind of funding for new NGO that wants to spread the use of games? Oh, great. I really love international partnerships. Tips. Okay. So, of course, there are great sources of information, and internet is one of them. I would recommend to browse the conferences, for instance, the professional conferences for video gamers and for the similar areas, to find a good practices session, to find the participants, because, and then it's also great to attend this kind of conferences, because usually you have matchmaking exercises and there is a floor for discussion again. And it's good also to try to look up in the internet for, look up the projects which might be relevant and interesting for you. And if you find them especially innovative for you and kind of fit into your imagination how to develop something new, I think you can just contact them. I develop quite a lot of project applications, but beforehand you have to really agree on the basic values, on the culture of work, on how you are going to develop the project, and then how you are going to implement it. So it's very good to involve the partner from the very early stages, because you can go through this process together. And after it's submitted and after you get the finding, hopefully, you will not ask yourself, why the hell we make this decision? And of course, always good to archive all these steps and to prepare some descriptions when you are developing a description of activities. And it's also good to try to find a partner which has some experience already. If you are, because you assume that you are a new NGO, well, you wrote it, so you are the new NGO. So it's good to find a partner which is more experienced one, especially in the international cooperation, because usually when the experts evaluate the calls for proposals, you can get some extra points for expertise and for experience. So if they successfully submitted some other international projects. They got the funding and they implemented with no special remarks, and the budget was accepted. It's also give you some extra credits when it comes to chances to get the funding. Helena, I do you think that I answered your question? Because I can just go on and on about it forever. It's kind of one of my specialties and priority areas to build international cooperation. It also depends on the program, but you might consider also having some dissemination organization, like, for instance, schools and all these community centers which are very close to the local communities. I think it really raises the chances to get the funding. Any questions? More? I would like to ask you if you have some recommendations for grants for project about rising cyber hygienic awareness in cooperation with Polish universities, for example, private company plus uni or NGO plus uni. For the first step, it will be the best to find some Polish grant. Okay. Cyber hygienic awareness. I should have some more details about it. Well, university is always Horizon 2020, but as I said, it's huge and it's complex and it's very complicated, and you have to have another international project. It actually depends on what kind of profile, because you tell me what is the theme, but I'm not sure whether it's going to be rather for civic competences or for like educational purposes, because maybe Erasmus Plus might be a good option here, because all the digital competences are of high priority as well. So I would suggest to try to read strategic partnerships from the Erasmus Plus. And it's not like, you know, Polish only grant, but it's being distributed on the national level. So your first contact when it comes to the grantee, it's the Polish agency, which is foundation of development of educational system. That's Fundacja Rozwoju Systemu Edukacji. So it's not that difficult. Okay, so I'm currently working on my thesis, which is a mobile game which goes to discover forgotten history of my hometown. From opportunities which you had described, I think the detective citizen. Yeah, sure. Well, I cannot prove you wrong, because I need to have more details. But if you have the NGO as a leader, and then you may find some other partners from your probably local environment or not. You may also try to find some partner in Norway, Iceland, or Liechtenstein. It's not compulsory, but it will give you some extra credits for your project. I think, why not? You need to check our website. We are going to publish in a month some rules and regulations, and there is an opening conference on February the 5th, so you are very welcome to visit it and then to get some more information and details when it comes to applying. Would you share some thoughts around fund opinion towards kickstarted funded project? I don't think I have some, to be honest. We would like to make it for public and administration and also for schools. Uh-huh. Okay. Erasmus Plus, definitely. Any more questions? I'm not actually very much experienced, and I don't think I'm an expert when it comes to Kickstarter funded projects. Thank you. Yeah, I think we have like 1 minute to go. So yeah, if you like, it's the time for the last question. Okay, still waiting. Okay, so if not, I think, thank you for all this great info heard about the new EOEIT, culture and creativity. I need to check it. So what is EIT, culture and creativity? So maybe I'll browse it through, and if it's something new, I'll add it up to my toolkit for you, which is summarizing various sources of funding. Oh, and if we have any people here, and I believe, Mihail, are you from Belarus? Because in the Active Citizens Fund, I didn't mention it, I'm very sorry. We can also have partners from the neighboring countries, which is Ukraine, Belarus, and Russia. So this is also a good opportunity to consider Polish partners. Okay, I think there are no more questions. So thank you all for discussions. Would be great to see you all, but well, I know the circumstances. It's always a bit challenging to talk to yourself rather than to the real people. But well, it is what it is, and it's good that we could meet. So you'll get in a couple of days some more info from you in the form of a document. Thank you all. I hope you enjoy it. Bye.